Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about X-ray diffraction technique. The name of my presentation is X-ray diffraction, all you need to know. So this presentation is basically based upon a book in which this all information is given. So elements of X-ray diffraction by B.D. Kulti. So please refer to this book if you want more knowledge, vast knowledge on this topic. And you can also leave comment regarding your queries. So I will try my best to answer to those questions. Let's get started. And so first we move with the content. And so we start with what, why and how of X-rays. Basically, what are X-rays? Why these are used for such a technique? And how get crystal information? After that, we will discuss about the machine, the X-ray diffractometer machine. After that, in the data, we observe some peaks. Each peak has a particular position, intensity and a width. So we will discuss about what are the factors which determine the position, intensity and width of a peak. Here we start with what, why and how of X-rays. The question begins, what is X-ray? So X-ray is the same as the visible light. It is the electromagnetic radiation. So here is a diagram in which we can see when an incident electron beam falls on a material. So we observe some backscattered electrons, some auger electrons, some secondary electrons. So there is a whole lot of explanation regarding this as well. And also we observe that there are some X-rays. According to Moseley, each material, according to its mass number, emits a characteristic X-ray radiation. So in this way, we get X-rays for any experiment. Now the question begins, like, why we use X-rays? So basically, X-rays have a wavelength which is comparable to the dimensions of interatomic distances. Visible light has a longer wavelength that can't go inside a crystal, but X-rays go inside and we can get a crystallographic information using X-rays because its wavelength, its lambda by 2, is less than the interatomic distance. So that is a minimum basic condition. Okay, so how X-rays are working? This is a diffraction experiment. As we have studied in our high school classes, that if parallel rays pass from a slit, so they get diffracted, and if the slit width is d, then the path difference introduced is d sine theta. In the second picture, we can see that if from an incidence of theta these rays are coming, so in that case they have path difference of 2d sine theta. This is highly intuitive that in first case this is d sine theta, in second case it is 2d sine theta. We are carrying the same example of image 2 in the case of atoms. We see that the interatomic distances play the role of a slit, and we have studied in our high school that this path difference should be equal to lambda or some integral multiple of lambda for getting a maximum. Basically, this is known as Bragg's law. So in this way, we discussed about what, why and how of X-rays. So now we know that how X-rays are working on a crystal, how X-rays are produced and why X-rays are used for crystallographic techniques. So now we move to the next thing, which is what is inside an X-ray diffractometer. So as we have studied in the last section, that when a high energy electron beam falls on a heavy metal, X-rays are produced. So here in this diagram, we can see that here is a copper target which is mentioned as A. This rotates at a speed of 6000 rpm using this rotor R, and basically from this point C, the high energy electron beams emit and fall on this target. Now the basic question is why this target is rotating. This is just to avoid heating because of electron beam. Additionally, this point S contains flowing water for cooling the system, and here you can see one window, so the emitting X-rays will come out of this system through this window. So in this way, so this system produces X-rays. So we assumed that this target is copper, which is emitting X-rays. So these X-rays, this is not a particular wavelength, but this produces a continuum of different wavelengths. So basically we can see in diagram 1 that the characteristics X-rays radiation are K alpha and K beta radiation, but there are many other wavelengths as well. For this we use nickel foil. So as you can see this dotted line here, so nickel absorption edge filter, this absorb wavelengths under this dotted line. After that we get this K alpha wavelength, which we can use for our experiment. This technique was used earlier, but nowadays some monochromators are used. You can see a monochromator in figure 2. In this there is one X-ray source, it is emitting X-rays on a spherical piece of quartz. So this system is set in a particular way such that for copper K alpha emission, this crystal obeys Bragg's law and emits only copper K alpha radiation. So this lambda is equal to 0.154 nanometer can be used further for investigation of the samples. Now in the next image, you are looking at a typical X-ray diffraction machine. In this, you can see that there is one source. From this part, X-rays are emitted. There is one sample holder. Here we place our sample on which the X-rays fall, and the diffracted X-rays are recorded by the detector. In this system, the sample remains stationary and source and detector both move. Now we are going to analyze the position, intensity and width of these peaks. This is a typical XRD data in which you can see that on x-axis there is the variation of angle, 2 theta angle, and on y-axis you can observe intensity. So you will see that at some particular position there are some peaks, their intensity is not the same, their intensity is different, and also these peaks are not absolutely sharp, these peaks have some width. So let us start with the peak position. So let us take an example of two-dimensional grid of atoms. So these black dots are, consider them to be some atom, and now if you see what kind of planes we can observe in this. So first of all you can see at this place where you can see the all the lines are parallel, so the distance between these planes is known as interplanar spacing. After that you can see this 1-1 plane, so these are a little bit closer than 1-0 plane. And after that this 2-1 plane, 1-3 plane, 4-1 plane. So different kind of planes can be observed. So if you look at Bragg's law closely, this point D is the interplanar spacing. So as the interplanar spacing changes, theta also changes. We are considering first maxima, so the value of n is 1. Lambda, the value of lambda is also fixed. The right part of Bragg's law is a constant. So towards left part, if you see, there are two terms, d and sin theta. So we can say that for getting a constant value, if d decreases, the value of sin theta should increase. And for increasing sin theta value, the value of theta should increase. That is the reason that why we get different peaks at different positions. Peak at a lower angle has the maximum interplanar spacing like this 1-0, and we observe different peaks at higher angle as the interplanar spacing decreases. So this is the basic reason the kind of plane which is responsible for a particular peak decides the peak position. Now let us talk about the peak intensity. So briefly let me tell you, like, the intensity of a particular peak depends upon the position of atoms within a lattice. To explain this, I can take one example. Take two cubic primitive cells. Now what we do, we introduce one atom in this. In left case, I am adding one atom on the upper and lower face. And in second, I am adding one atom at the center of the body. So in both cases, I am adding one atom. The contribution of each atom in the left case is half. So overall, this is one atom. And in the next cell also, there is one body-centered atom. So we can see in this picture that in the left case, there are only two planes. Now let us consider the path difference between ray 1 and ray 2 is lambda. So it should give a constructive interference. Similarly, if we see at the right, there is one more plane at the center of the body. So what we see that for ray 1 and ray 2, the path difference is of lambda. But just because ray 3 is adding and which is at the middle of this arrangement, its path difference should be lambda by 2. So in this case, we will observe a destructive interference in this case. So in this way, because of the arrangement of atoms, we observe some peak or we don't observe some peak. So basically, if I say in a nutshell, in this figure you can see that the first case is a simple cubic lattice. We observe these 20 peaks between 0 to 180 degree to theta angle for a simple cubic lattice, and for body centered, some of the peak disappear, and similarly for face centered, but the primitive is cubic for all the cases. So this is just a general example to show that peak intensity depends upon the position of atoms. So now collectively, if I want to summarize this, I can say that the overall intensity of a peak is because of the superimposition of all the constructive and destructive contributions, which is obviously guided by the position of atoms. Now at last, we want to discuss about the width of an XRD peak. So the width of a peak depends on two factors. One is the crystallite size and next is the lattice strain. So first of all, let me explain you what is the crystallite size. Not every material is totally homogeneous or continuous. It is made up of some small parts. And basically each part diffracts light at a slightly different angle. So that part which coherently diffracts the X-ray radiation. The crystallite size can be calculated by using Scherer formula. So this is the Scherer formula in which D is the diameter of the crystallite. And this is equal to K lambda by beta cos theta. K is a constant which depends on the shape of the crystallite, but on average basis we take it as 0.9. Lambda is the wavelength of the X-ray radiation. Beta is the full width half maxima of the peak. So how this crystallite size works? So if we imagine big crystallite, like a single crystal, in that case the whole piece diffracts light coherently at a single angle, so we observe some very sharp peaks. In the next case, if we see some small crystallites, so there are some different angles at which a single plane can diffract light, so we can observe a mild variation from the single peak. And when these crystallites are very small, then we observe a broad peak because all the crystallites are not diffracting light at a particular single angle. So this is the first reason how crystallite size is causing a broad peak. After that, we can discuss about the strain. So consider the case one in which we are not applying any strain to the crystal lattice. Now if we compress this crystal, we can imagine that interplanar spacing is decreasing. As interplanar spacing D is decreasing, according to Bragg's law, sine theta and the value of theta should increase. So in this way, we observe that the XRD peak is shifting towards higher 2 theta value. Similarly, in the case of tensile strain, when we are stretching the lattice structures, in that case, interplanar distances increase and theta should decrease. And in the case of case 4, if strain is not uniform, at some places this is compressive and at some places this is tensile. So in that case, basically the peaks get broadened. So FWHM of a peak increases in case of non-uniform strain in a material. So these two factors, crystallite size and lattice strain, are responsible for the width of a peak. Then how could you get what is the exact value of crystallite size or lattice strain? To do so, one could perform Williamson Hall fitting to get these parameters separately. I will also make a video on this later. So in this way, we have explained that in an XRD peak, what are the reasons for its position, for its intensity, and for its FWHM. Thanks for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe. And if you have any query regarding this, you can also comment in the comment section. Have a good day.